Thank you, Mr. Fraser. That concludes the debate on using the upcoming Scottish Budget to support economic growth. It's now time to move on to the next item of business. And the next item of business is consideration of Business Motion 15072 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. And I call on Jamie Hepburn to move the motion. Minister.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. No members have asked to speak against the motion. The question is therefore that motion 15072 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament is agreed. The next item of business is consideration of business motions 15073 and 15074 on stage one timetable for bills, 15075 on the stage two timetable for a bill, and 15076 on stage two extension for a bill. And I ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press the request to speak buttons. And I call on Jamie Hepburn on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau Minister to move the motions.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. No member has asked to speak against the motions. Therefore, the questions are that motions 15073 to 15076 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament is agreed. The next item of business is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau Motion 15078 on consideration of an SSI. I ask Alexander Burnett on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau to move the motion. Thank you. And I call on Douglas Lumsden to speak to the motion. Mr Lumsden, up to 3 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I actually lodged the motion to annul the SSI committee yesterday to give the committee an option to annul once we heard from the Minister, Jim Fairley. I didn't actually expect to actually move it yesterday, but after hearing from the Minister, I was convinced that this SSI should be annulled. Let me make a few points to start with. Annulling this SSI will not mean franchising cannot take place. Annulling this SSI will not delay any transport authorities bringing forward their plans for franchising. Annulling will not even delay the franchising process. Annulling this SSI will allow the government to change the legislation to enable us to have a process that works to allow bus franchising to take place if that is what our regional partnerships want. For me, annulling this SSI is not a party political point or a backhanded way to derail legislation that has been approved by this Parliament. But this is the committee process and the Parliament working as it should by providing the post-legislative scrutiny that it is meant to be doing. Yep. Presiding Officer, the franchising process was put into legislation in good faith, but we should have the courage as a Parliament to accept that the process has been tried in other parts of the country and has failed. It would be completely wrong of us to plough on regardless when we have taken evidence from people who have studied the franchising process and have told us that we should simplify the process. We heard yesterday that SBT, and for the Minister's benefit...
Take an intervention.
I will take the intervention.
Graeme Simpson.
I thank Douglas Lumsden for taking the intervention. Now, the Minister, when he speaks, may claim that voting to annul will bring work on franchising to a halt or take us back to square one. That would be completely wrong. I've spoken today to Valerie Davidson, the chief exec of SPT, and she says that nothing will change with them. They will continue to work on a strategy. They won't be in a position to decide on whether they want to pursue franchising until late next year. If they do decide to go ahead, it could be 2027 before any panel, and the issue here is about establishing a panel, was handed something. Now, does the member agree with me that this allows ample time to amend the legislation or to find another solution to have a workable and democratically accountable system?
Douglas Lumsden, I can give you some of that.
Okay, and I thank Graeme Simpson for that intervention, and it's good that he spoke to SBT today to hear exactly from them what the implication of annulling this SSI would be. And, you know, more than 2 years away, that's, you know, that means we've got ample time to amend the legislation and do it right. Personally, I would like to see the franchising process simplified. We can see from the Transport Scotland flowchart that the process is pretty long, with audit of financial implications and consultation built into the process long before any panel is appointed. So the government should take this time to review and improve the process. For me, this would not show weakness by the government, but would show strength, but would show that they are willing to learn lessons and implement good legislation that can actually work. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Lumsden. I now call Alec Rowley again, up to 3 minutes. Mr. Rowley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In yesterday's meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee, the committee agreed a motion to annul the SSI we are debating today, and that is the position that Scottish Labour supports. Despite the additional powers brought forward through the Transport Scotland Act 2019, intended to give local authorities the option of franchising bus services in their areas, bus franchising remains a complex process. One example would be the work of Andy Burnham has conducted in Greater Manchester to bring bus services under a franchise model. That process will have been ongoing for over 7 years by the January 25 date for full implementation, and has been subjected to extensive scrutiny during that time. Under the Scottish Act, this process would have also included a further 6 months process for an unelected official to have their say in the matter, when I believe that this should be for elected representatives of local authorities to determine. I also believe this view is in keeping with the spirit of the powers created through the Transport Scotland Act 2019. When we look at the work that has been done elsewhere in the UK on bus franchising, we see a country moving towards legislation designed to simplify the process. Whether it is UK Labour's Better Buses Bill or the work the Welsh Government and Transport for Wales have done on their roadmap to bus reform and franchising, the purpose of these exercises is to simplify the processes. It would be disappointing, therefore, if Scotland, having done the work to introduce a route to bus franchising first, was left with the most complex process in order to try and achieve that. I fully support the ability of local authorities to run their own bus services, franchise bus services in their areas, or enter into bus service improvements partnerships with bus operators within their areas. I believe the bus network in Scotland has suffered under the private operator model we have had for too long, and it is time that the power was put back in the hands of people and communities across the country to determine what is best for their area in terms of bus service provision. That is why I think it is crucial that bus franchising is made as simple as possible, and the annulment of this SSI is a step in the right direction to achieve that.
Thank you. And I call Mark Ruskell again, up to 3 minutes. Mr. Ruskell.
Thank you. It's clear our communities have suffered from years of bus services being run for private profit rather than the public interest. So change is desperately needed for the public to take greater control over how our services are being run. The SSI we're considering today would create a system whereby a panel of experts established by the Traffic Commissioner would have the final say on new franchising proposals. Yet the previous Traffic Commissioner was reported as making comments against bus franchising. And given the stated objective of the Traffic Commissioner is to, I quote, minimise regulatory burden on operators, it does not give confidence to transport authorities that their plans will be fairly judged. Now, the Minister attempted yesterday to allay these concerns by pointing to future guidance, but it's not clear how this will address the fundamental concern here. How will the public interest be reflected on this panel rather than it being dominated by members who have a largely technical view on bus operation coming from their experience in a privatised sector? Unfortunately, there are even, sadly, some in the private bus industry have stated that they see these changes as a form of theft of their very business model. Now, the Minister says these issues could have been debated in 2019 with the Transport Act, but of course SPT did raise strong concerns in evidence at the time. And in the original consultation for the bill, it was ministers who were to make the final decision on franchising. The switch to a panel in the final act was warmly welcomed by private operators, including First Group. What we know today is that the panel system has been discredited, and new models of partnership between national and local government appears the most effective and the most robust way to bring forward franchising. In the words of an advisor to the Welsh Government, the ongoing commitment to the panel process leaves Scotland as a backward-facing outlier on bus reform in the UK. Yesterday, as we've heard already, the NZ committee could not have been clearer in our support for new bus franchising and municipal models. But we need to make sure the legislation that underpins this mission actually works. So the Greens will be voting to annul this SSI, and it is up to the government to consider whether improvements can be made to the panel process or whether a change through primary legislation is now needed. Regardless of the outcome tonight, SPT will, I believe, continue to work on franchising over the next 2 years, even though there is currently no guidance from the Scottish Government. And I also spoke to the Chief Executive of SPT this afternoon. It is unlikely that any decision on any proposal that emerges from SPT's work will go for approval until summer 2027. So there really is time for this Parliament to fix this. And I'm sure that SPT and others will be prepared to work with Transport Scotland and ministers on further reforms that are needed, should primary legislation be needed. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'll take Bob Doris briefly up to a couple of minutes, Mr. Doris.
Thanks, President Officer. The committee was, I said, the committee was with one voice yesterday that we all support franchising. And much has been said of an independent panel system being a barrier to franchising. That was considered to be a position in relation to franchising with Nexus, I understand, in England in 2015. Our legislation was passed in 2019 and will have taken account of the situation some 4 years earlier. In 2019, the Parliament came together to decide that an independent three-member independent panel should be a final check and balance on the system. This SSI does not scrap that panel if annulled. The panel will still come into effect. It blocks guidance developed by the government in the public interest to make sure franchising has a safe, secure and public interest pathway. It would be a negative effect to block this guidance, in my view. That said, Presiding Officer, I don't think I have time, and I apologise for that, Mr. Lumsden. That said, Presiding Officer, any party, government or opposition, could look at an alternative to this and bring it to this Parliament. And if they did, legislative change could be forthcoming, and that legislative change would sweep away both the panel and the guidance. But to only block guidance in the public interest in this Parliament is ill-considered and ill-thought-out. So I say to Parliament, let's support guidance in the public interest, and if politicians wish to look again, then let's do that. And I will not be supporting the annulment here this afternoon, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Doris. I invite Jim Fairley to respond, Minister, again. Up to 3 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, I must express my extreme disappointment and, dare I say, my surprise at the short-sightedness in the decision of members of the NZ Committee who yesterday voted to move to annul these vital regulations, which is one of the very final pieces of the jigsaw that will allow us to undo some of the damage done to one of our vital public services by Thatcherism's obsession with selling off the nation's assets, and in this case, the maligned deregulation of bus services. The 2019 Act that was passed by this Parliament set us on the journey of giving the control back to local authorities in a number of ways to ensure that the people of Scotland have an affordable, reliable bus service that works for the people who rely on it most, rather than the dividends of payments for shareholders. Franchising is one of the most important and, dare I say, ambitious of these measures, and supporting this motion to annul puts the brakes on years of work in progress towards delivering that vision and turning it into a reality for the people of Scotland. And, Presiding Officer, it may well jeopardise the ability to deliver franchising progress in this session of Parliament. If we break it down into its simplicity, for what is in reality a fairly complex process. What this regulation does is allow the creation of a panel who will scrutinise the proposals of an authority to develop a franchise. ensure the robustness of its business case and be satisfied that the authority have done proper due diligence and consulted with the appropriate people, organisations and neighbouring authorities so that all considerations and required actions have been completed. It cannot be the case that such a major financial and socially important decision should be taken without a full and robust scrutiny. And the very presence of a panel to carry out that role will be the insurance policy that we need, that authorities will adopt the level of rigour required to get this process right and to get it right first time. The Labour Party position that panels don't work because of the experience of in England simply does not stack up, because that single panel decision that they based the comparison on is comparing apples with oranges. That panel looked at only the financial business case, which was not robust. There are many other arguments that could be made, Presiding Officer, but with an eye on time, I'll confirm what I told the committee yesterday, and I instructed the Chief Executive Officer of Transport Scotland to talk to the CEO of SPT, the only authority currently looking at franchising as an option. Some would say the trailblazers for future possibilities, and their response was emphatic. SPT is currently developing a new regional bus strategy. This is a quote. While this strategy is yet to be finalised, in their discussion, SPT noted the importance of checks and balances with the franchising process. Given this is amongst the options under consideration, should these regulations be annulled, they felt it would not be suitable to leave the primary legislation in its current form with no support and regulations. They highlighted the need for a quick resolution to the current position, noting that any legislative changes should be delivered timorously and have intimated a desire to work collaboratively with Transport Scotland and other partners to identify a workable solution. I don't know if you can hear me, Presiding Officer, because all that's noise.
Minister, can you resume your seat? Minister, resume your seat. Can I remind members, they are perfectly entitled to ask for an intervention, but it is at the discretion of the person who has the floor whether or not he or she takes that intervention. There should therefore not be heckling. There should not be conversations around the chamber. Let's listen to the Minister concluding his remarks.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In the interest of time, I will continue, because there's a lot of points to get through here. As they continue to develop their regional bus strategy with franchising as one of their options, what they need is certainty of direction. This regulation delivers that certainty. Annulment takes certainty away. If this annulment is successful, it is possible to continue with the progress of the legislation. A panel would or could still be established, but no one other than the Traffic Commissioner would have any say on its parameters, its guidance or its timescales of implementation. There will be no government input into one of the most fundamental safeguards that this legislation is designed to do. It will be left entirely up to the Transport Commissioner. That, Presiding Officer, is simply untenable. The other flawed option being proposed.
The Minister
by
is concluding, and he does need to conclude.
Pardon?
The Minister does need to conclude. It was up to 3 minutes.
The other flawed option being proposed by others is the change to primary legislation. Presiding Officer, at this point in the parliamentary session, that is simply too untenable, which means franchising would be delayed into the next session, with whatever make up the government that delivers. And again, no certainty for the people who rely on this most. The most used public transport service we have, and that is too high a risk to take when we have already come so far delivering what the people have clearly stated they want.
Minister,
Officer, I can understand if there is a desire to kill the idea of franchising. So the Tory position on this is
Minister,
understandable.
Minister, can I ask you to resume your seat a second? I've asked the Minister to conclude. I will not be back, nor will he. I'm going to start naming individuals if they're not careful. Minister, but you do need to conclude. You are well over time and we are already behind time.
Bear with me, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, if the Labour and the Greens vote with the Tories today and annul these regulations, then they will have effectively blocked franchising from proceeding in Scotland for years to come. The SNP knows where we stand in this. We stand for improving the bus network for the benefit of bus passengers, operators, local communities and businesses. We hope, even at this stage, Labour and the Greens recognise that this is where they want to be too. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question on this motion will be taken at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau Motion 15079 on approval of an SSI. I ask Jamie Hepburn, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move the motion. Minister.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I call on Liam Kerr, who joins us remotely, up to 3 minutes. Mr Kerr.
Yeah, I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer. I wish to speak against the motion to pass the coronavirus extension regulations, but let me be clear exactly why. I find myself in the perhaps unusual position of actually understanding where the Cabinet Secretary was coming from with regard to the continuation of many of these measures when she was responding to questions on this in the committee. However, we cannot ignore that this legislation was brought forward in response to a pandemic situation, most of whose direct impact ceased around 3 years ago. There can be no analysis whereby good practice is to simply extend legislation brought in during an emergency in a vacuum of scrutiny. And that's why I have concerns about the fiscal fines regime aspect of this SSI. Presiding Officer, a fiscal fine is a direct measure which prosecutors may offer to an accused as an alternative to prosecution in court. The legislation which the government seeks to extend today increased the maximum amount that can be issued through a fiscal fine to £500. However, data shows that around two-fifths of accused who rejected a fiscal fine faced no further action. In short, criminals, for that is what they are, if they are in this situation, not only avoid a court process and indeed any sanction, but of course victims are left in the dark as a result. The problem is then compounded by this SSI, not only bringing more criminals within scope, but 3 years on, the government still hasn't bothered to collate reliable, up-to-date data showing what the outcome has been of this so-called temporary change to our law. And I think it's instructive that the Scottish Government itself appears to recognise this and the need for much greater scrutiny of this change, in that it seeks to make this change permanent in a forthcoming bill. Perhaps by then, they will present robust, comprehensive data from the increase and thus adduce evidence as to why this measure is required and whether the stated outcomes at the time have been achieved and will continue. In the absence of such evidence, it is deeply inappropriate to extend legislation on the nod. And for this reason, I ask Parliament to vote against this SSI.
Thank you. I now call on Angela Constance to respond. Cabinet Secretary, again, up to 3 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Colleagues will remember that the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Act 2022 included a number of temporary justice measures to make sure that our justice system was able to respond to the acute impact of the pandemic. While there has been significant progress towards recovery, we still have some way to go. Therefore, it is necessary to extend the remaining measures for one final year so that they stay in effect until the end of 30th of November 2025. And this move has been backed by our justice partners. There has been considerable progress in reducing the backlog of cases in the courts, with outstanding scheduled trials falling by over 45% between January 2022 and September 2024. However, modelling by the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service anticipates that backlogs in solemn trials will continue above the target baseline until 2026-27. Therefore, these measures will ensure court resources are used efficiently. The availability of the higher maximum fiscal fine means that, where appropriate, more summary cases can be diverted from prosecution, reducing the number of cases that go to court. We are talking about cases that would normally, potentially, if they were not subject to a fiscal fine, would go to the Justice of the Peace Court and in all likelihood be subject to a financial penalty. So there is a pragmatic reason for the use of fiscal fines. And I also, following my evidence session to committee recently, Presiding Officer, followed up in correspondence with committee on the 24th of October, outlining further information and presented particular data to the committee. And Parliament might want to be aware that the Crown Office also regularly updates Parliament on a range of matters relating to its functions. Turning to the two extended time limits, these are for one further year only. There is no power to extend these beyond next year, and we are not introducing primary legislation to extend them either. These regulations are necessary to increase the court's capacity to hear trials by, again, ensuring that the resources are not diverted to holding large numbers of procedural hearings to extend time limits on an individual case-by-case basis. And I'm sure Parliament does not want to risk compromising the court's capacity to focus on progressing trials and reducing the backlog. As the Lord Advocate highlighted to members on the 10th of October, removal of the time limits right now would present a serious risk that victims and witnesses may be deprived of their access to justice. Presiding Officer, to conclude, just to say that I acknowledge Mr Kerr's comments. There are indeed a limited number of these temporary measures that are being baked into permanent legislation that has been introduced to Parliament. And I believe that these regulations are a package and they are crucial to assisting the continued recovery with Parliament, and I propose the SSI to Parliament.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That question on this motion, again, will be taken at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of three Parliamentary Bureau motions. I ask Jamie Hepburn, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move motions 15080 on approval of a UKSI, 15081 on approval of an SSI, and 15094 on committee membership. Minister.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question on these motions will be put at decision time. And there are a mere 10 questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that motion 14879 in the name of John Swinney on a motion of condolence be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament is agreed. Second question is that amendment 15063.3 in the name of Jenny O'Gall-Ruth, which seeks to amend motion 15060 in the name of Miles Briggs on funding for teachers and schools in Scotland be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament is not agreed. There will be a vote. Therefore, there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.